Okay, I guess we should be starting. Hello, Kyiv. So it's my first time here. I really appreciate you are here. We came yesterday, and I must say I love the city already. Who among you have hit the party yesterday? Hands up. No one? A couple of people. So we have to talk afterwards because I'm looking for a good recommendation for tonight, okay? So my name is Jakub Pilimon. I'm working as a software consultant in architecture. And when I do not code, I run classes about DDD, test-driven development, and architecture. So today I want to talk about events with you. So first of all, why do we use events in our daily basis work? In my opinion, there are at least a couple of reasons. From my experience, it shows that it enables us to invert the control of our flow of the program. That's the first reason. The second reason is because it enables us to give us event-driven architecture, buzzword, right? So the consumer doesn't know who the producer is, and the producer doesn't know who the consumer is. We have loosely coupled microservices. The third reason would be to build up event sourcing. Anyone heard about event sourcing? My God. Okay, almost everyone. But the definition will come itself later on, okay? So I had a handful of slides prepared, but at the last moment I decided to throw them out and just use live coding. So I hope the live coding demo and guts will be today with me. I will use like two or three slides anyways. So we can start. I will build a small application backed by Spring Boot. And do not be worried if after 10 or 15 minutes you won't see any kind of event and it will be like pretty simple. We have to build the foundation to go with the complex stuff later on, okay? So every code that we'll write down here today will be available at my GitHub account, so feel free to take a look. Here is the URL. Here's my Twitter handle and my Gmail account, so if you want, drop me a line, give me feedback, positive or negative. I appreciate both of them. And let's get it started. So I will just write a simple domain model, and every domain model, almost every one of them, has a concept of a user, right? So I will create a class called user. Oh, by the way, is the font big enough for you guys in the back seats? Cool? Okay. A little bit bigger, okay? Let me fix it. Should be somewhere here. Fonts. 24, let's make it 26. How about now? Cool? Okay. So, the concept of object-oriented programming is different than we are used to. The problem with object-oriented programming is the fact that, and actually this is a quote, is the fact that it is called object-oriented programming, not message-oriented programming. So we should be starting with behaviors, not with data structures that the user has, but what possibilities it has, what behaviors it exposes, right? So to capture those behaviors, I recommend you such techniques like event storming or domain storytelling, but we don't have time for that. Oh, by the way, this quote comes from the inventor of object-oriented programming, Alan Kay. So let us assume we enabled three behaviors, we found three behaviors on our user. For example, I don't know, we can activate the user. To make it symmetric, we can also deactivate the user. We can, let's say, change his nickname to some new nickname, of course. And we can also ask the user three questions. It will be pretty simple. Hey, user, are you activated? Let's return false to make it compile for a while, okay? The second question will be, hey, user, maybe you are not activated, so you are deactivated. Return false again. The last one would be, hey user, what is your nickname? And to make it compile, I will return an empty string for a while. So we have the behaviors. We are not thinking about data structures, just the interface. The second thing that we should do is to capture the invariants, so the state protections that goes behind the commands. So what is protecting me from going to the inconsistent state with my user? I personally like to write down those invariants, those scenarios in test cases. So I'll create a test for that. I will name it user test. Sounds fair enough. Anyone uses Spock? It's like JUnit, but a little bit better, okay? In my opinion, personal. So I will use Spock. It's pretty simple, you will see. So I'm writing down the behaviors, so the invalid state transitions and valid ones as well. Let's say that the activated user cannot change his nickname because this is the behavior of our application, let's say. Second one would be activated user can change his nickname. That makes sense, right? And the third one would be deactivated user can be activated. The fourth one would be symmetric. Activated user cannot be can be deactivated. Sorry for the typos. Okay. The last ones would be that deactivated user cannot be deactivated again because it doesn't make much sense. And the same with the activation. So activated user cannot be activated. So we have the invariants written down as the test cases. Now, what we should do is to try to implement those cases one by one, probably to do test-driven development, but we don't have time for that, to let us implement that upfront, all of them, okay? So let's create a user with some unique identifier. Let's say user is identified by unique UID. We should create this ID here and inject it via constructor. Cool, it works. And deactivated user cannot change his nickname means given user, which is deactivated, when someone tries to change his nickname to Julia, it's a pretty name, Julia, then user, or we cannot do it, so let's say illegal state exceptions being thrown. But activated user, so given user, which is activated, when someone tries to change his nickname to, or it should be, shouldn't be his, could be her, of course, Julia, then user get nickname should be Julia. Pretty simple enough. We need that to build more complex stuff later on. Deactivated user can be activated. So given user, which is deactivated, when someone tries to activate him again, then user is activated. And activated user can be deactivated. So when someone activates the user, and then when someone deactivates him, user should be deactivated. Okay? And the last ones are pretty the same. Given user, which is deactivated, when someone tries to deactivate him again, then again, illegal state exceptions being thrown. I think I can copy paste this here because I'm a lazy programmer and change it like this, that activated user cannot be activated again. So let's run those tests, I guess, and I hope they will fail because we don't have an implementation yet. Yes, they are all failing. So now would be the time to write the implementation. So we are starting again with those invariants. We have behaviors, now invariants. Activated user cannot be activated again. So if he is activated, we will be throwing new illegal state exception, right? Cool. Deactivated user the same. If it's deactivated, then we are throwing new illegal state exception. Cool. Change his nickname. Only it's possible when the user is not deactivated. So I can copy paste this here. And now data structures. So data structures, the least important stuff. If we think about behaviors, invariants, backed by test cases, and then think about data structures, it let us go. Let us end up with minimalistic design. Okay, so let us say that a user can have like state. State would be an enum. I'm choosing an enum. Can be a flag. Why not? We've initialized, activated, and deactivated. So user, of course, has its state. initialized to initialized, fair enough. And he will be having his nickname backed by a string. At the very beginning, an empty string. So now we can go here and say, okay, if the environment is passing, I can mutate myself. State is equals to activated. Here, state is equals to deactivated. Here, we are changing the nickname to nickname. It should be this, right? And three questions that we are asking our object. Pretty simple also. Not returning false, but we are now returning, hey, if my state is equals to activated, that means it is true, I am activated. Same here, if the state is equals to deactivated, right? And here, we will be returning nickname. And now, I would hope that our test, or at least a couple of them, will be green. All of them are green, we have the model. But the model itself is not very useful, right? We have somehow to persist that. So let's write a simple repo here. I will name it user repo. Oh, you know what? Let's make it an interface because we'll have a couple of implementations. Later on, we'll go with event sourcing, so we need an interface. Let's make an interface. A user repo interface exposes two behaviors. Pretty simple. We can save the user by his UID, with his UID, and we can load the user by his UID. So the second behavior would be like this. It's not compiling, now it's compiling, cool. Let's write an implementation. Simple in-memory implementation. What happened here? Cool. And I hate this name. So I will rename it to in-memory user repo. And we can keep the users in the hash map, OK? So it will be private final map from UID to user, so key value, map of users will be new concurrent hash map. And when we are saving the user should say, OK, I have my UID, so I can go to users map. I'm putting new value here. User get, I need the getter for UID. So let's create that. Create getter, cool. And here I'm saying a new user is being saved. And when we are loading, simple enough, just we had to get it from the map as well, right? By UID. So now we can write tests for that behavior and then switch to event sourcing and we will see whether those two test cases will be passing. So let's write the test, create test, user repo test. Simple enough. User repo equals to new in memory. Will be very, very simple test because we need it to go with more complex scenarios. So this basically should say, hey, I am able to save and load a user, right? This is the responsibility of the repository, isn't it? So should be able to save and load user. So given some random UID, what's going on here? UID, yeah, random UID and some user. And let's say someone is mutating this user, okay, to simulate more complex scenario. User is activated and someone changes his nickname to Julia, her nickname. When someone's loading the user to a different object from the repo, so load by ID, then a loaded user get nickname should be Julia, and loaded user should be activated, right? Because we activate the Julia before saving to the repo. Okay, we'll run this test. I hope it will be green. Oh, it's not green, it's null pointer, get nickname, because we didn't say anything about this. or we are mutating wrong object right here. Change his nickname to nickname. And what happened here? Which one? Ah, yeah, of course. I didn't save it to the repo. Thank you, guys. I don't have any gifts. Excuse me. As the repo save the user, now it makes sense. Yeah, it's green. Thank you. So this is very simple scenario. And then now the more complex stuff. So let us look at let us take a look at the user and what's going on here. We have those three commands, three behaviors that the user exposes, right? And if we take a look, it has some pattern. First of all, we can run a command against the user by expose behavior. This is a command. Second of all, the user says, OK, I'm accepting your command, but I don't know if it's true. So I have to check my invariants. So I'm checking the invariants. And if they are not true, I'm saying to the client, go to hell. I'm not accepting that. This is an ACK, basically, right? The command can be not accepted. But from this point of view, from this line, I'm saying this is accepted. This is happening. I will convert my command to an event, okay, or series of events. So basically, this is the way to find the events in your domain model. This is basically everything that is mutating state after checking the invariants. How to check, how to find the name of the event? Basically, I recommend you such a technique. Try to extract this method and try to name it. What's the name of that method? Should be probably user activate user, something like that, and add past tense, so user activated. This is how to find the name of the event. Same here. If we do like this, user deactivated. Cool. And same here. So I'm trying to name it. Change nickname. Nickname changed. User nickname changed. But this is the first step. The second step is, what is the content of my event? How do I know what's inside of my event, right? But the IDE gives that for free. Because everything that will be extracted to the method in the parameters, so it can be more of them, right? Here, blah, blah, blah. Everything that is there is basically the content of the event. So I can use like method object, a parameter object pattern, and have everything in one object. Here's only one, but imagine there are like three of them. So we capture all of the parameters in one object, and we name it the same like the method is named. So this will be new user nickname changed. The content is, as we said, nickname, and every event should have a timestamp. It goes without saying, right? I have to know when the event happened. So I'm putting here instant.now. It's happening right now. Let us make it compile. So I'm creating this class. I have to bind the parameters to the fields like this. And I guess I will be needing getter for that nickname because we have to add this as a parameter. So refactor. And here, I don't like this name. Nickname change should be here. Nickname changed. And basically from this point, we are saying that new nickname is the one coming from an event. Okay? If we have it, we can do the same stuff with previous events. So here, user deactivated. Also just a timestamp. We are creating this class and binding the fields. And I feel like pretty safe when copy-pasting user deactivated to user activated because they are the same. User activated. So we have all of the events. Now we have to make it compile. And the last stuff is here, new user activated instant.now. So now we found those events, but they are like up in the air. They are not persisting anywhere. They are not consumed. They are not persisted, right? So We have the events. This is the way to find the events by analysis like behaviors, invariants, and then state changes, which is basically equivalent of forming an event. And now would be the time to write a new repository, and we will be keeping them, keeping the state by series of events. So the first slide I will use, it's here. It's basically, the event sourcing comes like this. You are not storing the state, but you are storing only the changes to your state. That allows you to consume all of the stream and produce the current state. Or you can cut it in the half and produce state in the middle. So you can check out at the very specific moment you want to and see the state from the specific moment. I think it's not a new idea. You guys are using some tool every day on a daily basis that works like this. What's the name of that tool? Git. It's probably Git, right? This is exactly Git. Event sourcing is also backed in Git. So the idea is not new. What I have to put in my code is some kind of a mapper who would say that, okay, the events from this user are here and the events from that user are there. So I have to have those lists because they are in order, and every list should be mapped to some UID of the user. So we'll write a new implementation of our repo here, implement, and we'll name it event sourced repo. Okay? Not this, but this. We're implementing that, and as we said, we need some kind of a mapper from UID to the series of events. So I'm putting here private final map of UID to list of the main event. Now we know that there is a time for some marker interface that will gather all of the events. Let's name it events, initialize to concurrent hash map. And let's actually create this interface. Create interface. Called domain event. Domain event should have at least one behavior, should be able to say when it happened. So instant timestamp, right? You're gonna import that, yeah, cool. Make it compile. And now we have to do not fun work to implement all of the interfaces, all of the classes with the domain event interface. Gonna do it quickly, I hope so. Implement method, return now. I think I can copy paste that because, as I said, I'm a lazy programmer. The activated user implements domain event. Yep. And the last one here, domain event. And here, cool. So let's go back to the event source repo. When we are saving the user, that basically means adding new events till the end of the at the end of the stream, right? So we have all of the events that were gathered previously, and now we are adding new events. So let's actually write down what I just said. Current events are the main event. Current events, I can take them from the map. And if the map is empty, I want an empty list, right? Not null. So get our default. User get ID, and if it's empty, just give me new array list, so empty list of events. Probably the first time we are saving the event, the user, right? And to list of current events, I'm adding all of the new events, and let's say that user, because he's the one who is throwing the events, knows the answer to that question. So what are the new events? So user get pending events. We have to write down, we have to create this method, actually, create getter. It's gonna return list of domain events, right? Cool. And we have to import list, and to avoid non-pointer exception again, new array list here, right? So the user keeps the events. So to make it work, every time the user is throwing a new event, we have to gather the event in the internal collection. It would be here. Pending events at user activated and user deactivated as well. Pending events at user deactivated. And the last one here, pending events, add nickname change. Cool. We have it. And now we are safe to save the new stream of events. So enhanced and reached by new events. So we are saying, okay, we have a new stream. We are saving this here. So events, put user get ID, so under this key, and current events, enhanced by new events. And last thing we have to say that, okay, user, you did your job. We flashed your events. Now you can clear them out. So basically, equivalent of dirty checking in ORM, right? We are checking whether the object is dirty or not. If it's dirty, we are saving the state and saying, okay, you are now clean. The same here. This is the same scenario. Flash events. So that we have to create that method and say, we have to say, now the internal collection is clear. It's cleared. That was the easy part. The more complex part comes here. We have to somehow recreate the state, so consume the stream of events and create the state, right? So how to do that? Let's start with some factory method on the user, recreate from. We're gonna pass, of course, list of events related to that user. And we're gonna pass UID. Might be useful. We have to create that method, and now, basically, consuming the state of that stream. Is anyone familiar with functional programming here? This is basically left fault, right? So we are consuming the stream of events and producing internal state, and each handler produces new state that goes with the new handler and so on and so forth, up to the very end, or we can cut in the middle. So Java 8 doesn't support left fault out of the box. We can play with reduce, we can play with weird for loops, or I can cheat and use Java slang and make it one-liner. And I'm preferring that, okay? Java slang, collection, list of all domain events. We can now static import that. And fold left, what is the parameter? I forgot. It's zero, so the initial state, and then the handler method. Two parameters. What is the initial state? It's, of course, new user from UID. And I'm going to use compiler here, compiler hints. I have to pass lambda here. So how I treat the next event? The event can have three forms, activated, deactivated, and user nickname change. So I guess I have like I must have like one big handler for that. Let's name it user handle event and create that method here. And I think I can just use method reference here right now. And this is one-liner, okay? And this guy hopefully says instance of, instance of, instance of. Or I can again cheat with Java slang and use pattern matching, another pattern from functional programming, okay? So this is basically left fault and pattern match. Not here, but here. It's gonna say API match event. I'm matching the event, and I have three cases. Case one predicates if the event is instance of user activated, then I'm running this code. This. And what I should put here? I should put the handler of that event, but hopefully we already have that. We did it at the very beginning when trying to extract the method. This is the method we created at the very beginning. So here we are writing user activated. Here this user activated, and I have to import that. And it's not compiling. It's not compiling because every transition should return mutated state, right? For the new events. So we have to come back here and see that user activated is not returning anything. It's mutating, but not returning mutated state. So I'm going to say return this for the future handlers. And I have to say the same with all of the others, right? Here and here. Okay, and now three other cases, two other cases. I can copy paste that. Here, here, and here. And when it's user deactivated, I'm gonna run this method. So basically, it's pattern match, right? If it's this, then that. If it's that, then this, and so on and so forth. User nickname changed, then I'm running this method. And I hope it will compile. Otherwise, I'm screwed. Nickname changed. Yeah, and it's compiling. And now the very important part, because we have this stupid test for in-memory repo, right? It's called user repo test. We have new implementation of our repo that should be basically working. And now, when I go and change the implementation of the repo under test, I guess it should still be working, because the contract for the user, for the end user, should be the same. He doesn't care whether it's event sourcing, whether it's in-memory hash map or RAM-based, blah, blah. He wants to save or load an user. Let's write it, and finger crossed, it's green. It's green. So it's working. And let's check whether user test works still, because the behavior of the user shouldn't change as well. Only the persistence mechanism. It's green. OK, what can it give us? If we take a look, why do people use event sourcing? Because it's a natural audit log for your application, right? So we can take a look. User activated, deactivated, activated, user created, user deleted, and so on and so forth. This is natural audit log, and it's better than audit log that is alongside your database, because this is audit log that we are recreating state from. So this is basically cannot be not true. This audit log is always true. Second of all, we can cut the stream in half and recreate state from the past and check whether or what happened on production 2 days ago, why we kept having those exceptions over there. So I can write this method. Let's try it, actually. I never tried that, but I will try it right now. To recreate state from the past. Should be fairly easy. So I will create a second method here. Should say load an user with this ID, but at this time, right? Import class. Okay. So I'm importing at this time, and I should not be passing all of the events, but I should cut my stream up till at, right? So I will have dot stream dot filter event. Hey, event, have you happened after at or before at? I'm interested only before at or at. So it's not after at. So event timestamp is not after at. And collect collectors to list, right? I have it. Let's write a test for that, because otherwise we don't know and have no idea whether it works or not. We are writing a test. And of course, I will copy paste everything. And we will have it right here. I will make it bigger. Should be able to load user from past, let's say like this. We are traveling back in time, like in the movies. So this is given UID, given a user who is activated, who then changes his nickname to Julia. Then we are saving the user, and now we can get rid of that, I guess. Saving the user, and the important part, and some time has passed, so we'll simulate it with time sleep. Time unit, milliseconds, sleep 2000, so basically 2 seconds. Not a good idea to sleep in unit tests, I agree, just a showcase. And then someone is saying, hey, user, can you change his nickname to Anna, right? And we should say user repo, Anna is being saved right now. So we have two state changes, Julia and Anna, and we should be able to gather them all. In ORM-based scenario, we should be able only to gather Anna, but here we can say, should be when. And then, when someone is loading the user right now by ID, so what should be the nickname here at current time? Should be Anna, right? Cool. And if I am loading from the past, so I need that method expose, so I have to do like this, and then UID, and we need to load state ago 2 seconds ago and a little bit, so it's gonna be instant now. Minus 206, let's say, and then the nickname of that user should be Julia, right? And 1 second, we should be basically here, right? So it is more than 2 seconds. 1 second would be Anna still. We are waiting, and it's green. So we can go back in time in event store scenario, which is not possible in ORM-based system. Audit log comes for free. This is the second advantage. The third one would be we can basically send our event log to someone else, and someone else can have a different perspective on our event log, right? I don't care what you think about my event log. But you can have like different perspective and do like the normalized view, anomaly detectors, in-memory super cool, fast hash maps, whatever you want. And me as a producer of that event log, we don't even care. Consumers care. It's like in real life, right? Real life works the same. There is a past event log. For example, me and my ex-girlfriend, we had a past event log of our relationship, and we both had different perspective on that. Like, and I always kept saying, I have optimized projection for my needs, and you have for your own. You don't understand event sourcing, I said to her. Then we broke up. I don't know why, but shit happens, right? So to send this event log to someone else, we can use a marvelous tool, which is called Spring Cloud Stream. Anyone used Spring Cloud Stream? It is a tool from guys from Spring Cloud, of course, which enables us to talk between microservices via messaging infrastructure. And we don't have to write all of the burden that comes with us when we have to connect to the infrastructure, because the framework does it for free. And the scenario we will build, it looks like this. We'll have like user service, which we created right now. We'll have message broker in the middle and some different application, let's call it UI. So to enable Spring Cloud Stream, I have to say, hey, dear Spring Cloud Stream, you will be having connection to one channel, because Spring Cloud Stream operates on the abstraction of the channels. It's broker agnostic. So I will have one channel, and my application, user application, is basically a channel which produces to one output channel. So I can say that my binding will be enabled by this class. Comes for free. So I can say I am producing to one output channel, which is called output, by the way, and that is why I'm the source. I'm the source of the events, right? The second thing I have to do is have to check my properties. Oh, it's already there. I forgot to cut them. So I have to say, hey, Spring Cloud Stream bindings to the output channel, the one we defined 2 seconds ago, should be here to user's destination. And depending on third thing, so what I have on my class path, I have Kafka binder, for example, it will try to connect to Kafka topic named user. If I had like RabbitMQ binder, he would try to connect to exchange.user. This is why it's broker agnostic. It's very easy to exchange brokers. But I'm choosing Kafka. I hope it's running in the background. Yeah, it's running alongside with the zookeeper. And let us create a new class which will be sending those events to Kafka. I will name it Event Publisher. Makes sense, I guess. Just Event Publisher. Let's make it Spring Component so that it's backed by Spring. Spring Component, and it will have like one method. And I want logging also. Public domain event publish. And domain event. Why such a weird signature? 1 second, and I'll explain. I want to log it. Info about to send an event, which is basically this one. And I'm just returning the event. And Spring Cloud Stream, or to be honest, Spring Integration, which is the foundation of Spring Cloud Stream, if I a note that method with a publisher method annotation, and I will say to the channel source output, everything that will be the returning parameter from that method will be sent to Kafka topic named user right now. So the channel named output, which is bound by my properties to Kafka topic, okay? So I'm having that, and I want to publish those events, and who knows about events? Event source repo, so let's go here, and event source repo, we have to make it a Spring component as well, I guess, and inject event publisher, right? Event publisher, cool, it's already there, and for all of the new events, which is basically here, new events, we want to publish just the new events, right? So here we can say new events, hey, for each event publisher, publish. Should be working. So now, anytime someone saves anything from our user, so when the user changes his state, it will be propagated to Kafka broker topic users, okay? So I will just simulate this production behavior that someone keep creating in users, okay? Let's say every 2 seconds. So I will enable scheduling here, and I will have scheduled method every 2 seconds. Let's say so 2,000 millis. I will name it public void create random users. Right? Cool. That's a cool signature. And I need a repo here, right? I almost forgot that. Final user repo. There is only one implementation backed by Spring, event source repo, so I guess he will inject the proper one. Let's see. We have user repo. And now user equals to new user by some random ID. Let's say we are activating the user that should produce the first event. A second one will be produced by changing the nickname. We'll be changing the nickname to some random one. Let's say UID, random ID to string. Not very humanish name, I agree, but let's keep it like this. And user repo.save, of course. And user. And if we try to run it, just double check, we have enable binding here. We have property file which says output map to destination users. We have publisher created like this with component to the source output, and also we have Kafka binder on the class path. So I guess we are pretty ready to go and start this application. Let's start it. Kafka broker is running in the background, and I have only 8 gigs of RAM, so it will like start. It will be starting like for a while. Okay, excuse me for that. Oh, it started, cool. And it is publishing some events, as we can see, but as my final act, we'll try to gather them at the second end, okay? So I have a second application. Let us copy paste all of the events to the second application, which is also Spring Boot backed. And here we'll be copy pasting the events. And also double check here, do we have properties file like here? Here is input, because I'm input to the channel, the same channel users, so it's okay. On the class path, I should be having also Kafka to listen to port and default port and default localhost with the Kafka broker running on my machine. And I have to enable binding, and in this scenario, it will be enable binding, it will be just getting one channel of events. So this is sync pattern. So I can use sync instead of source, sync class. And one more method to have those event handlers, right? The method that will be invoked every time something comes on the broker. So I will have stream listener here to the channel. I guess it was channel or not. Value, source, not source, sync, input, public void, handle event by interface, domain event, and let us just log it here, received info, right? Info received, and this guy. Stream listener to the input, binder, it's there, class path, it's okay, and property file is okay. We are ready to go to start this application. And here we will probably be building something more complex than logging, but some projections, some read model view on a normalize, and so on and so forth. Let's see whether it works. It's connecting, and it's keep getting, every 2 seconds, we should be getting some new events, right? So it's very, very easy in Spring Cloud Stream. It's a marvelous tool. Marvelous tool, because in a 1 second, I could change the broker to RabbitMQ. It comes with different connectors also. I don't remember, but it has different connectors. It's very easy to enable event-driven architecture in the Spring Cloud ecosystem, okay? So, to conclude, I would like to thank you, first of all, and I wanted to show that event sourcing you can do without specific frameworks, okay? I cheated a little bit with Java Slang. We can do without Java Slang, but it would be longer. You can use pure Java with Reduce, something like this. It's not architectural pattern. It's just a pattern for one object, two objects, the model. When the model is good enough, so when the model is exposed by behavior, not by data structures, then it doesn't really matter whether you are persisting it with ORM or event source. From the client perspective, it didn't change. The repo and the user test, the repo test and the user test were still green, and we didn't have to change anything there. So we can have natural audit log, and we can have we can go back in time with our state to check what was the state of my object some time ago. And if we took a look at the user one more time, it's not here, but here, what happened here? It's too big. Okay. It's basically, it can be persisted, can be used like this. You don't need any ORM framework here because your ORM can be backed, your events can be backed by ORM. You don't save user. So basically you go without something which is called impedance mismatch. So the difference between the relational world and the object-oriented world and the bridge between them by ORM, which always causes trade-offs. And in your domain model, you don't want trade-offs, right? So here you can do proper object orientation with event sourcing and or functional programming if you want, right? So that would be it. I want to thank you guys. I think we have some time for questions, right? If not, I will be here the rest of the day. So if there are questions, I'm happy to take them now or later on. We can grab a beer. Thank you.